please welcome to the stage IBEW member Loli Chung.
Good morning, union brother and sister. My name is Loli Chung, IBEW Local 3 journeywoman and non-traditional employment for women new graduate. Right. 45 years ago, my father came to this country because he believes that this country is the greatest country in the world. Without an education and not able to read, speak, nor write English, my parents worked in all kinds of low-paying jobs in order to support the family. I saw how my parents struggled. Luckily, my mom found work at a garment factory in Chinatown, and my father got a job as a cleaning staff at the Baruch College. When I said luckily, it was because both were union jobs, and they both became union members. My mom's union is International Ladies Garment Workers Unions, and my father is in Union Local 1597, New York City Custodial Assistant Employees, DC 37. Unions have transformed my parents from working poor to a respectable middle class life. They became homeowners, retired with union medical benefits and pensions. The children followed their aspiration for a better life. We believe education is the ticket to good jobs. Both my sisters and my brother graduated from college. My major was toy design, and I had a full-time job working as a model maker for a toy company. However, with the internet and globalizations, my job got outsourced to China. So I went back to college again and got another degree, this time in computer graphics. I could only find freelance jobs without health insurance nor benefits. During the Great Recession of 2008, there was no work and no income. At that point, I realized, even with an education and dedication, I still need a union job to stay above water. In 2011, I signed up with NEW, and I started my apprenticeship with IBEW Local 3, and learned to become an electrician. 5.5 years later, I become a journeywoman. Thanks to my union, I have pensions, 401k, health benefits, and saving in the bank. I enjoy middle-class life. And my family benefits from my union job, too. I can support my nieces to go to college with my earning. Angie is studying in University of Buffalo, and Lillian is at Stony Brook University. The third girl, Emily, is a junior in high school, and if she wants to go to college, I will support her. The American dream is about upward mobility. The positive impact of union jobs benefiting my families spans 3 generations. With unions, just like my father said, America is the greatest country in the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Loli. Appreciate you kicking us off this morning. And good morning, everyone. The convention will now come to order. We have a very busy day ahead of us and a lot of thoughtful discussion and debate. Looking forward to that. We're going to take on some of the most important issues of the day. Our fight for democracy. Building our political voices for 2022 and 2024. Building the strongest possible state federations and central labor councils, fighting for clean energy jobs, repairing the care economy, the fight for racial justice, global solidarity, and immigrant worker power. Those are just a few of the topics we're going to cover today. So we are so excited that you're back and ready to go to work. That's right. We're also going to hear from Stacey Abrams. And the President of the United States is here. This is where it all happens, my friends, right here. We are the epicenter, the American labor movement. And as I mentioned yesterday, you all know this, the hall is going to be locked down at 10 a.m. So if you want to see President Biden speak, you will need to be inside of this hall, Hall D, from 10 a.m. until he is finished speaking. So you ready for it? Okay, that's what I thought. We have a great day ahead of us, and I know this morning's invocation is going to get us all in the right headspace to take it on. So please join me in welcoming Imam Kenneth Nuruddin.
Good morning, everyone. Peace be unto you. I am Kenneth Nuruddin, the Imam of the Philadelphia Masjid, but I want to welcome the AFL-CIO to Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love and sisterly affection, on behalf of the Religious Leaders Council of Philadelphia and the Delaware Valley. And this council is comprised of the Archdiocese of Philadelphia, the Board of Rabbis, the Black Clergy, the Episcopal Diocese, many of the major religious institutions. We all join together and welcome you here to our city. And I want to commend your president, not President Biden, but President Shuler, because I want to thank her for the invitation. But she reminded me of something when she spoke on Sunday, that the religious community and the labor movement have been two of the major entities for progress in this country. And so we serve as the legs of society that gives us movement towards greater equity. And as she reminded us, we have to remember that we are here a few blocks away from where documents and resolutions were put together that are our inherited legacy. And so we can't forget the principles that we stand on, because we are here as a united people. We can say we the people in order to form a more perfect union, to form more perfect unions. We ask Almighty God to bless us and to help us unite our hearts so our unions can be better, so that we can establish justice and provide for the domestic tranquility and the common defense and promote the general welfare and secure the blessings of liberty for ourselves and our prosperity. And I want to leave you with a few verses from the Bible and the Quran. The Bible reminds us, and it really gives us instructions, and it's addressing all of us, because through the revelation that came to prophets, we are told, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn away from the harmful things, I will hear them from heaven and I will heal their land. So we are here inheriting the best of both worlds. We have the prophetic traditions and we have those documents that we stand on as a foundation that enable us to meet the challenges that we are facing in the 21st century. So we ask Almighty God to bless the leadership of the AFL-CIO and the various unions, and to guide them so that they can give greater leadership to their constituents. We ask Almighty God to preserve all the good that they have done in the past, and the resolutions that are made today and this week. We ask that those things be preserved so we can benefit from them and future generations can also benefit. We ask Almighty God to bless the union leadership with the insight that is necessary to chart a course in an environment that is fraught with challenges and difficulties. We ask Almighty God to protect the union leadership from the challenges and the strife that affects many of the efforts that we make today. We ask Almighty God to bless the union members with the skill sets that are necessary to be competitive in the modern world. We ask Almighty God to enable the union membership to join and reap the benefits of the fruits of their labor in a more equitable way. We ask Almighty God to bless the union leadership and to bless the unions with the production of goods and services that will not only make life more amenable, but will also enable us to meet the challenges of the 21st world when it comes to global economy. And in closing, there's a verse, a chapter in the Holy Quran that we can benefit from. And it reads, A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim, bismillahi rahmani rahim, wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr, illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihat, wa tawassaw bil haqq, wa tawassaw bis sabr. As time passes along, human beings' condition doesn't improve. It deteriorates unless they have faith in something that is greater than themselves, and they have faith in themselves, and they have faith in each other, and they join together to do things that are productive and beneficial. And they live in a world of reality. They accept the reality, no matter what it is. And they are patient and they are constant in fulfilling the duty that is on them. So we ask Almighty God to bless the union leadership, to bless the union membership, and to bless all of us, and to permit us to live a life that is pleasing to Him. Amen.
Thank you, Imam Nuruddin. And now, let's welcome to the stage Bricklayers President Tim Driscoll, who's representing the Credentials Committee for the Credentials Committee report this morning. Tim.
Thank you, Liz. Good morning, sisters and brothers. Since the Credentials Committee last reported 15 additional delegates and 9 additional alternates whose credentials had previously been approved by the Credentials Committee have registered. In addition, in the interest of full participation at this convention, the committee has approved the credentials of 2 delegates and 5 alternates whose credentials were received late. The Credentials Committee recommends the additional delegates and alternates be seated. The complete list of delegates and alternates is being submitted for the record at this time. On behalf of the committee, I move adoption of the Credentials Committee report.
Ends that the report of the Credentials Committee be adopted. Is there any discussion? Okay, seeing none, the question is on the adoption of the Credentials Committee report. Those in favor of the report, raise your badge and say aye. Those opposed, raise your badge and say nay. The report is adopted. Motion carries. Thank you. Thank you, Tim. Okay, we are here together to talk about our future as a movement. And so much of what the future looks like is going to depend on what we do between now and November 8, Election Day. And on what we do between now and November 5th, 2024. Elections have consequences. and they turn on the choices we make about mobilizing, organizing, getting out the vote. So let's take a look. Roll the video.
It was an historic turnout for early voting.
Elections matter.
Many young voters.
Not just how they end, but how we get there. Disinformation leads to distrust and discord.
Trump would have you believe those numbers are made up.
It's up to us to break through the lies. Because when we speak out and we turn out and the truth wins out,
Joseph R. Biden Jr. is elected,
we get the most pro-union administration in history. A union leader as Secretary of Labor.
Mayor Walsh for a cabinet position.
I'm a 33-year member of Labor's Local 223 in Boston, Massachusetts.
A White House task force on worker empowerment and organizing. And a historic investment in our infrastructure, our jobs, and our future.
$1 trillion infrastructure bill.
Upgrades to the nation's roads.
Bridges and broadband, ports and airports, water pipes and railroads.
Millions of jobs.
New energy solutions, new union jobs. A stronger labor movement, and a stronger middle class. But we can't stop here, and we can't stop now. Election Day is 5 months away. So let's keep fighting for a future with better infrastructure, a stronger care economy, labor law reform, a more just immigration system, and robust voting rights. Let's get to work.
There's probably no one in this country who understands how much our elections matter than the way our next speaker does. When Stacey Abrams ran for governor of Georgia in 2018, she had to fight against a system that was built to work against her. But after the election, she didn't give up. She got to work. She organized, registered, and mobilized more people in Georgia than anyone thought possible. And union workers were right alongside her, turning out the vote. I saw you out there knocking on all those doors, because labor was the one on the doors and making those phone calls. And together, our efforts elected President Biden, giving us the most pro-union administration in history, and elected Senator Ossoff and Senator Warnock, delivering a pro-worker majority in the United States Senate. And Stacey's work made all of that possible. And her opponents know that. So since then, they've waged an all-out assault on voting rights in Georgia, making it harder for working people to vote. And let's be very clear about the racism at work behind these attacks. Making it harder for black and brown workers to vote. Her opponents are doing everything they can to change the rules and rig the game. From making it a crime to give people waiting in line for hours, making it a crime to give them water while they wait in line to vote. To closing all but one polling place in Lincoln County, a county twice the size of Philadelphia County. Stacey's opponents are desperate to restrict the vote, to make it harder, even impossible, for everyone to exercise their democratic right to vote. But Stacey knows, like we do, the power of collective action, of organizing, of speaking out. She knows, like we do, that solidarity moves mountains. And she knows, like we do, that the fights for voting rights and workplace rights go hand in hand. These are fights for our voices to be heard. Just as every worker deserves a say in how their workplace functions and the policies that come down from the bosses, every voter deserves a say in the policies that come down from the leaders of their state and their nation. When we can raise our voices, we can hold those in power accountable. And that is how we build a better future for working people. And she knows that. She knows the future of workers and the future of our democracy are inextricably linked. In fact, she believes in the role that unions have to play in our future. So she knows deeply. And she actually, in her State of the Union response, You may remember she gave it from a union hall. So I cannot wait to see where her vision takes us next. So please join me in welcoming an unparalleled champion for democracy, for worker rights, and for justice, the next governor of the great state of Georgia, Stacey Abrams.
She stood up for freedom and equality. Used her voice to save our democracy. That's Stacey Abrams, a warrior with diplomacy. Hey, don't you dare. With Miss Stacey, she knows how to fight
her.
Don't you ever mess with Miss Stacey.
Thank you to President Shuler. Thank you to Secretary Treasurer Redmond. Thank you to the delegates for having me here. As Liz pointed out, I am from the great state of Georgia. And with your help in November, I will become the governor of the great state of Georgia. The campaign that we're waging in Georgia is a campaign that is being waged across this country. It's a campaign that acknowledges the pain, the real pain that people are feeling, the economic pain, the continued challenge of COVID, the concerns of racial justice and injustice, the concerns about what the future holds for those who call themselves Americans, for those who call themselves people. We know that across this country, people are trying to figure out who they are and where they are headed. The pain is real, but so is the promise. And too often we're told that we've got to choose between one or the other, that we can't acknowledge the challenges we face if we want people to have hope. But we can't ask people to have hope if they don't know that we know what they're feeling. And that is where labor sits. You sit in the moment where pain becomes promise, where challenge becomes choice. You sit where we are when we decide who we intend to be. And it is my honor to be with you today to talk about how we grab that promise. I've been hearing a lot about the enthusiasm gap, that in the wake of the last few elections, we're destined to lose opportunities because there's an enthusiasm gap, but I reject that. There is no enthusiasm gap. There is a trust gap. For communities that have been left out or left behind, for communities that are suffering, or communities that simply don't see a path forward, their challenge is not that they're not enthusiastic, they just don't trust that anyone understands what they need. But you are a community of organizers and you have long spent your time building bridges across that trust gap. And in 2022, that's what we've got to do again. We've got to explain to families that they can trust us with their children, that we can educate and protect them against the things that happen outside the classroom, but also protect them within those walls. That we can build cathedrals to learning rather than fortresses of fear and protect our children in this country. That we can absolutely invest in our educators and make them guides to the future, not guards against the past. We have the responsibility in this moment to tell everyone, regardless of where you're from, that we can protect the Second Amendment and protect second graders at the exact same time. That's who we are. Thank you. To bridge the trust gap, we've got to speak aloud our values. We can't be afraid to declare who we are, because we don't make choices and we don't make change if we don't tell the truth. That also means we have to tell the truth about the economic challenges we face in this nation, but that we know those challenges aren't permanent. We know they didn't arrive in 2021 and they're not going to disappear overnight. But people need to understand that we see the pain they feel, that we know that there are those in the working class striving to make it to the middle class, and there are those in the middle class trying to sustain, that those challenges are real, but so is the proof that more can be done. Because with labor on the rise, we know that wages will go on the rise. With labor on the case, we know that people's lives get better. But we have to have leaders who understand that the resources coming to our states belong to the people, not the politicians. We need to have leaders who understand that their responsibility is delivering responses to the challenges we face, not trying to buy political favors from those who already have enough. And it is labor that has always understood how to deliver for the people. I'm running in a state where we have one of the top places, we're one of the top places to do business, but we struggle in so many other ways. Where we are number one for maternal mortality, number six for infant mortality, number nine for gun violence, number 48 when it comes to providing mental health supports. We are number two in the uninsured. But I know that if I get the opportunity to lead the state, we'll be number one in the promise of the future, and that is what we can accomplish for so many communities across this country. We have to be able to trust in our educators in helping our children. We have to trust that we can build a sustainable economy for our communities, but we also have to trust that we can defend and protect our rights. Our civil rights, our human rights, our voting rights. Those are challenges that we face. And the reality is that there have been those who have been fighting for 50 years to take away those rights. They attacked the Voting Rights Act in 2013. They are attacking my right as a woman to control my body in 2022. And they're coming after other rights. But we've got to remember that these are inalienable rights, and they don't have the right to take it away. But we cannot be silent, and we cannot be still. We know that these rights are not only defended in Washington, D.C., they sit in our halls of power at the state level. And you see, those who want these rights to be stripped away have been working at it for a while. I grew up in the Deep South, and I can tell you what their playbook says. You see, most of the changes we face in this country didn't happen in Washington, D.C. They happened at the state level. You see, stand your ground didn't happen in Washington. It happened under Governor Jeb Bush in Florida. Mass incarceration didn't start in 94 in Washington, D.C. It started in 1970s under Governor Ronald Reagan. We know that the erosion of the social safety net didn't happen in 1996 in D.C. It happened in 1990 under Governor Tommy Thompson. And Jim Crow never had a single federal law. It was all governors in the South who said who we were going to be. And it's going to be governors in the South who say who we're going to be next. That is the opportunity we have in this nation. And that is the opportunity of this election. In this room is the chance to change the world. And it happens in November 2022. In 21 weeks, we can tell America who we are and who we intend to be. In 21 weeks, we can shift the narrative from headwinds and losses that are expected to miracles and to showing people who we can really be. You see, I come from a state of miracles because Georgia has shown y'all over and over again who we intend to be. And we can do it again across this country. But we've got to do three things, AFL-CIO. Number one, we've got to speak up. When we hear the narrative about how we've already lost, we have got to push back harder and harder. We've got to declare that the game is not over until we have won, and we will not let them tell us the future before it arrives. We've got to speak up. Everyone say it with me. Say, speak up. Y'all can do that better. Say, speak up. Thank you. We've got to speak up about the challenges we face, but we've also got to speak up about what's already being done. The infrastructure money that is making sure we have employment across this country. The monies that went into communities to save people from evictions. The opportunities that those dollars are providing. But we know that that's not enough when the gas prices are rising, but wages are not. And so we've got to speak up and say that it's not enough to get one moment of grace. We deserve grace every single day. We've got to build a movement to meet the moment. So we need to speak up. When the pundits and the disinformation start to flow, we cannot nod along or whisper to one another. The other side will tell a lie so often it sounds like the truth. We tell the truth one time and think that people should say hallelujah. We've got to tell the truth over and over and over again until people knows it, until they understand what the truth really sounds like. We've got to speak up. But number two, we've got to stand up. We've got to stand up to those who tell us that we are not enough. We've got to stand up to those who are passing laws to tell our children they're not enough. We've got to stand up to those who are passing laws telling us the future is not enough and doesn't belong to us. We're going to watch these hearings over the next few weeks, and we're going to know what happened in January. But I know what happened on January 6th. I want to know what happens in January 2023, and January 2024, and January 2025. We have got to stand up and declare who we intend to be. So say it with me, say stand up. We've got to stand up to those who would tell us that this is not our nation, and that we don't deserve its protections, that we don't deserve to be wholly who we are. We've got to stand up to those who will tell us that we've already gotten everything they intend for us to get. We've got to speak up. We've got to stand up. But my favorite is we've got to show up. Say, show up. We've got to show up every single day between now and November. We've got to show up in communities that don't expect to see us. We've got to show up with people who don't think that we can hear them. We've got to show up for places that have been left out and left behind, and we've got to show up in the places where we think we've already won. You see, there are no permanent victories in politics. There are no permanent friends, no permanent enemies, just permanent allies. And if we stand with our allies, even if we don't agree on every issue, if we show up together, we will show out and show America what can be. We can do that, AFL-CIO. We can do it by calling and texting and door knocking. We can do it by doing our best up and down the ballot, remembering that our states are the crucibles and the laboratories of democracy. We can do it by showing that in states where we think we've already lost, that victory is ours, and in places that we've already won, the victory remains. We can show up at the ballot box. You see, there are those who believe that the answer is protest and others who believe the answer is voting. I believe in protesting at the ballot box. I believe that voting isn't magic, voting is medicine. And if we take our medicine, we can change our direction. But we cannot do it alone. And so, delegates, I'm here today to say thank you for what you've done. But I'm also here to call on you to do a little bit more, to pour in a little bit more, to stand up a little bit longer, to knock a little bit harder, to talk to the people that you like, but talk to the people you don't like, the people you're afraid of, the people you owe money to, the ones who owe you money. We've got to talk to everyone because our future is on the line. We can meet this moment, and we can make this moment ours, but we've got to believe we have the right to be, because we are going to do what? We are going to speak up, say speak up. We are going to stand up, say stand up. We're going to show up, say show up. And we're going to show out and show America exactly who we are. So let's go get it done. Thank you so much.
She stood up for freedom and equality. Used her voice to save our democracy. That's Stacey Abrams, a warrior with diplomacy.
Isn't she fantastic? Isn't she great? You see, she, Stacey Abrams, is why we fight. She is why voting rights matter. This is why we need to fight for our democracy, so that we can elect excellent leaders like Stacey Abrams in fair and free elections. Let's hear it again for Stacey. You know, but there are a lot of people in this country who are threatened by Ms. Abrams and her radical pursuit for the restoration of voting rights and her fight for free and fair elections. They want to make it harder for us to participate in our democracy. And us, in most cases, means people of color and the historically disenfranchised. And one of those people who are scared of Ms. Abrams is sitting in the governor's mansion in Atlanta right now. He signed a voter suppression law last year one of the most restrictive measures since the Voting Rights Act of 1965 was passed. Why? Because he decided the wrong people were participating in our democracy. He decided that the wrong voices were being heard. But he doesn't get to make that decision. We do. So, that's right. So we're going to get out the vote for Stacey Abrams and make damn sure that come November, Governor Kemp will need to have moving trucks and file for a change of address. That's right. There's no question we are at a pivotal moment for our democracy. So we've invited our next speaker to join us because he has examined the state of our democracy inside and out. He sees the cracks, right-wing attacks on our voting rights, the undermining of our democratic institutions, misinformation and disinformation campaigns, censorship and the distrust of the media, economic inequality, and he knows and he uses an historical lens to see how these cracks can be exploited by the right wing and authoritarians, and how the progressive movement can prevent our democracy from crumbling. He says that history does not repeat, but it does instruct. In fact, that's how he opens his book on tyranny. This country's founding fathers looked to ancient Greece and Rome for instructions on how to form our democracy. And we must once again look to the past to save it. And when I say we, I mean our government right here. Our next speaker, Professor Tim Snyder, agrees. He knows the labor movement is uniquely situated to lead the fight to save democracy and heal democracy. And he's going to share what we can learn from the past to inform the fight for a better future. Brothers and sisters, that's our duty, because we do not want 2022 to be our last free and fair election. And we do not want that kind of history to be written on our watch. So, coming to us by video, all the way from Austria, please welcome Professor Tim Snyder. Roll the video, please.
Thank you. Greetings. It's great to be with you. I'm coming to you from far away because I've got to be far away. I'm a historian of a different part of the world, and I've got to be thinking about a different part of the world these days. The part of the world that I'm thinking about is Ukraine, and I'm just going to say a word about Ukraine because I think Ukraine helps us to see where we are. In Ukraine today, in the war in Ukraine today, we're watching a violent assault on an imperfect democracy in the name of a big lie. In Ukraine, we have a Russian tyrant who's trying to overthrow an elected government by force. This is the way that history can go. This is the way that our history can also go. The war in Ukraine, horrible though it is something like January 6th, just on a larger scale, when the tyrant can use more violence, when the tyrant is sure that he can win. We should care about this. We should care about Ukraine because it's very much about right and wrong. We should care about this. We should care about the war in Ukraine because it's being fought by the working people of Ukraine. It's the working people who are doing the fighting and the suffering and the dying. We should care about this because democracies rise and fall together. They always rise and fall together. And we should care about this because January 6th delighted tyrants all around the world, delighted oligarchs all around the world, because the tyrants and the oligarchs understand what January 6th means. They understand that January 6th could be a turning point. They understand that January 6th is something we have to learn from and not just prevent, but as Stacey Abrams was saying, make a turn towards a much better democracy in the future. The case I want to make to you is that our democracy depends on you. I'm a historian speaking to you about the past, but I'm speaking to the people who I think on whom I think history depends. And it's a great honor for me to do so. The reason I think history depends on you, democracy depends on you, is because democracy is about three things. It's about representation, it's about law, and it's about good faith. Representation means we all vote, or we should all have a right to vote. As Stacey Abrams said, as all of you know, we should all have a right to vote. It should be easy to vote for everyone in this country, African-American or otherwise. We should celebrate the vote. Democracy is also about law. Voting should translate into changes of people and into changes of policy. But finally, and this is the hard part and the part on which everything else depends, democracy depends upon good faith. Someone who's aspiring to become a dictator can bend the law. Someone who's aspiring to be a dictator can pretend to represent the people. And this is the way that democracies are usually broken, from within, with a plan that abuses the institutions, with a plan that involves some violence, as we saw on January 6th. And as we also saw on January 6th, and this is true in history, it's been true throughout the 20th century, it's true now, the aspiring dictator tells lies. This is what I mean by bad faith. The aspiring dictator tells big lies, a big lie like that he won an election that in fact he lost. Now, a big lie like this, it's not just a falsehood. It's not just some kind of normal political misdirection. A lie on that scale creates a cocoon. As we see in this country, it creates an alternative reality where other people can live, an alternative reality where our voices don't count, an alternative reality where ultimately no one's voice is going to count. So we know, as we look towards November of 22 and November of 24, that anyone who is using the big lie to make it harder to vote is an enemy of our democracy, is weakening our democracy. Anyone who is running for office on the strength of the big lie is working to change the regime of this country, is working to bring our democracy down. So this November is an opportunity. It's an opportunity to win. There are so many things to win, but it's not really an election that we can afford to lose. Who can stop all of this? Unions can. It was so kind in the introduction to hear about my little book on tyranny, and I'm so glad that I mentioned unions in the second lesson of my book on tyranny, because as I say, you are at the center of history now. You have to be at the center of history now. Democracy needs the groups between the government and the people. When I say democracy is about representation and about law and about good faith, that's all true in principle. But democracy only works when there are groups between the government and the people. Those groups that we call, that historians call civil society. You are civil society. Labor unions are civil society. Labor unions are the most important example of civil society. Unions give people practice in representing themselves and their interests. They give people practice in voting. They give people practice in defending the vote. Unions work within the law. They work to improve the law. Unions bring people together, people of different backgrounds, different creeds, different classes, different races. And unions, and maybe this is the most important thing, unions create the space where people can get to know each other, where people can tell the small truths about daily life, the small truths about labor, the small truths about politics that help us get us through a big lie. And that's the only way to get past a big lie, is all the small truths, the millions of small truths represented by Americans, represented by your members. In a world of big lies, in a world of internet propaganda, there is no substitute for that. There's no substitute for people organizing people. There's no substitute for people getting to know people. So I thank you. I thank you, organizers. You're at the center of history now. We know from the past that unions have resisted all forms of tyranny, all around the world. We know from the recent past of this country that smaller unions have made it harder for us to be a democracy. So I'm wishing you, Liz Schuler, and all of you, I'm wishing you success in growing your unions. And I'm thanking you for what you're doing and thanking you for what you're about to do. Again, it's been an honor to speak to you. I wish I could be with you. Thank you very much.
Incredible. Incredible. Thank you so much, Professor Snyder. It really resonates when you say there's that alternative reality that's been built, and who can break through? Who is uniquely positioned to do that? And it's us. It's the labor movement. We bring people together. So thank you so much. We appreciate you being here. Very informative. You have inspired us, and you've challenged us, and that's what we need. So thank you. All right. I'm just going to say, is everyone ready to do that, to use the power of our movement, to use our network, to break through and have those one-on-one conversations? Absolutely. Because those conversations are what bring us back together from across the divide, as Professor Snyder said, and they're how we drown out the big lie and break down the barriers and find common ground in our lives. And these conversations are going to lead to a stronger democracy at the workplace and at the ballot box. So are we ready to commit the time and the resources necessary to have those conversations and rebuild those connections with our members? That's what I thought. This is the moment for us to take this challenge on. So if you take one thing away from this convention, it's that we need to go home. We need to build those connections, we need to reconnect with our members, and we don't have any time to wait. So let's get started. I want to welcome AFSCME President Lee Saunders, Chair of the Executive Council Political Committee, and AFT President Randy Weingarten, Chair of the Executive Council Committee on State, Local, Labor Councils, and Community Partnerships, to lead us on our plans to win in 2022 and 2024. I could not have better partners as we build this political program. So welcome to the stage, Randy and Lee.
Morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. Okay. I want to thank President Schuler. You know, 8 years ago at AFSCME, we made a fundamental change in how we do business, specifically how we engage with both members and potential members. We launched a new program called AFSCME Strong, which put internal organizing front and center. This was back to basics, a return to the old-time religion that gave our movement its strength in the first place. We had more than 1 million one-on-one conversations with our members and potential members. We looked folks dead in the eye and talked to them, heart to heart. We had these conversations at work sites. We made house calls, knocking on people's doors. We talked about the power of the union difference, about the way union membership lifts up our families, the way union membership strengthens our communities. And we didn't just talk. More importantly, and I want to stress this, more importantly, we listened. We gave people the opportunity to tell us what they care about, what challenges they face at work, what inspires them, what moves them to action. Through these conversations, we became a more member-driven union with a stronger culture of activism. We built greater affinity. We built greater solidarity. We moved from a servicing model to an organizing model. You know, in the face of relentless attacks, we could no longer afford simply to have a transactional relationship with members. We needed members to take greater ownership in the future of their union. to claim a bigger stake in our fights. And 4 years ago, when the Supreme Court's Janus decision made the entire public sector right to work, AFSCME's strong paid huge dividends. Anti-worker groups like the Freedom Foundation were ambushing us with drop campaigns, contacting AFSCME members and telling them to walk away from their union. But because of AFSCME Strong, because of those one-on-one conversations, because of all the ways we had improved member communications, our AFSCME family heard the truth before they were exposed to the lies, before they were exposed to that propaganda. They were armed with the information they needed to tell these corporate front groups to go straight to hell. In overwhelming numbers, loud and clear, our members said, we are sticking with our union. We are sticking with our union. We are sticking with our union. One-on-one conversations are also at the heart of our political programs. We began running what we called hybrid campaigns, which blended our electoral work with our internal organizing. Hybrid campaigns are year-round. Let me stress that, year-round. They don't start a month or two before Election Day. And they start with a conversation about the union and what's on the members' mind, not with who's on the ballot, not with an ask to show up at a rally or contribute to our PAC, but to listen to what our members have to say. Hybrid campaigns allow us to first establish a connection, a rapport with members, and only then do we begin talking about candidates and politics. And in those conversations, we focus on local issues that most directly affect members and their communities. I'm very proud that the AFL-CIO's new political program is modeled after AFSCME's hybrid approach. The focus of the program is on authentic, long-term, in-depth, one-on-one conversations, discussing the issues members really care about, and then linking those concerns to candidates, linking those concerns to the ballot. Those conversations also drive our member-to-member communications and messaging. What we learn in those conversations help us craft the scripts, the leaflets, the texts, the emails, and other materials. The program emphasizes what we call relational organizing. We know that people respond best to political messages delivered by those they know, those they trust, not by out-of-state canvassers who blow into town to do GOTV for a single weekend and then leave. So our program doesn't just depend on member-to-member communication. It also requires strong relationships with grassroots partners who have long-standing relationships and credibility with their neighbors and their communities, and a deep understanding of local issues. This political program is a combination of old school and state of the art. It includes traditional elements like door knocking and phone banking and worksite visitations. But it also takes advantage of text banking and social media and online tools. And the program comes with accountability measures. We need those accountability measures. It includes goals, timelines, and metrics. Union family, this approach works. It really works. It is the best way to mobilize our members, drive turnout, and ultimately win elections. Now let me introduce to you AFSCME International Vice President Dave Henderson. Dave is the Executive Director of AFSCME Council 13 right here in Pennsylvania. And he can talk about his experience leading successful hybrid campaigns. Dave?
All right. greetings, sisters and brothers, and thank you, President Saunders. I appreciate that, and congratulations, President Secretary Terger. Appreciate it. As Lee very accurately depicted the outcome of the hybrid plan, I'd like to share with you what Pennsylvania's been doing since 2016. In 2016, following the success of our Ask Me Strong campaign, which focused on our movement through member-to-member conversations, Council 13 embraced the hybrid campaign approach of 2017 and we've been using it successfully ever since. While we all know the importance of electing pro-union candidates, we found in Pennsylvania, like I'm sure most of you, that conversations that begin on a political note are often deemed to fail. However, when conversations start with bread and butter issues, how it's going at work, and making ends meet, we found our greatest successes. The hybrid model allows us to get back to the basics of listening to our members and focusing on the issues that matter most to them. We talk about workplace issues, contract negotiations, and the services and benefits that AFSCME can provide to our members. Only then, and only then, do we transition to the political conversation. And we have to be comfortable with that political conversation. Because at that point, they see the bigger picture, and they understand why their union is involved in the political arena. On top of that, we focus our political ask on the issues that are important to them, rather than getting bogged down in those divisive topics. We make it personal. Like myself, and I'm sure many of you, our members are sick of the negativity. We want to focus on what we can do to make a better life for our members, both on and off the job. We want to show them we're not here to support one political party or another. We're here to advance our middle class agenda. And winning elections is just one important part of that. We build our communications program around the issues the members tell us they want to hear about. Eventually, we layer in conversations about our recommended candidates, we make the link to supporting those candidates, and we move them to the act of voting. But this is only after we develop a deeper understanding of and a relationship with the member. It's about quality over quantity, again, making it personal. We've seen that deep member conversations, meeting the members where they're at, just as Secretary Walsh recommended yesterday, going to our members, and understanding the issues that are motivating them have been critical in moving effective member communications programs. Again, we've made it personal. Our hybrid model brought us major successes with the re-election of Governor Tom Wolf in 2018 and the election of President Joe Biden in 2020, when Pennsylvania was the keystone to his victory. Let me share with you that in 2018, we knocked on over 80,000 doors with a contact rate of 40%. 80,000 doors Council 13 members knocked on. In the 2020 campaign, during the height of the pandemic, what we were able to do is we used wellness calls, again, reaching out to our members, meeting them where they're at. This year, we'll continue our efforts to mobilize our members to elect another pro-worker governor in Josh Shapiro, as well as a pro-worker, pro-union senator in John Fetterman. Yes. We look forward to continued member engagement, productive conversation, and electoral success with our hybrid model. And we are excited to share that success with our sisters and brothers in the labor movement across the nation. This is how our movement will meet the moment. Let's do this. Thank you.
Thank you, Dave. Let's give it up for Dave, okay? Give it up for Dave. It really does work. It really does work. To maximize the effectiveness of this new political program, we must have a sturdy infrastructure. This will only work if we have strong state federations and strong central labor councils with the resources and the capacity required to execute the game plan. To talk more about that, I want to introduce my sister, the president of the American Federation of Teachers, my buddy, Randy Weingarten. Randy?
I love that. I love that song. Thank you, Lee. And it is really, I'm really excited about this, that you've noticed the state and local bodies and the political program are pulled together under Liz and Fred's leadership, as you'll see from the two resolutions, for very good reasons. Our political program and our state, area, and local councils are really inextricably linked. In fact, as you just heard from Lee, our political program depends on the strength and the effectiveness of our state and local organizations. And it was abundantly clear when I joined President Saunders and President Shuler, I love saying that, at the kickoff events in 9 of the battleground states for the 2022 elections. The grassroots level is where elections are won or lost. It's frankly where we have the momentum for legislation. It's where unions grow and what makes our communities stronger. So I've been honored to chair the Committee on State and Local Labor Councils and Community Partnerships, and I'm honored to have a co-chair in the indefatigable Jimmy Williams. And I've been privileged to see and lift up a lot of the good work that so many of our state federations and local labor councils are responsible for. This is, as several of the speakers have already said at this convention, it's bottom up, it's member driven, not top down. We need to support the grassroots of our movement so we can meet this moment. They are our infrastructure, they are our muscle, and it is how we connect on a local level. And let's be real, it's our communities. It's where we live, where we worship, where our kids grow up, and where we create community. So I've asked 4 of our state and local labor body leaders to speak about the key programmatic areas we rely on them the most for: politics, legislation, community, organizing. They are part of that critical infrastructure so our movement meets the moment. First up is Bernie Burnham. Bernie is the president of the Minnesota AFL-CIO and former president, yeah, we can clap, Minnesota must be in the house, and former president of the Duluth Federation of Teachers. And she's going to talk about how they applied the lessons they learned from Janice, lessons that are very similar to what President Saunders talked about, to the political program in this very important battleground state. Bernie. She's here somewhere.
Well, thank you, Randy. Glad to be here. The Minnesota AFL-CIO is ramping up our new political program that President Saunders just spoke about. And you're right, it is reminiscent of what we did when, in response to Janice, when I was the president of the Duluth Federation of Teachers. It was clear we needed a plan to ensure our members understood the value of belonging to our union. With the help of our state union, Education Minnesota, we were able to have one-to-one conversations with every single one of our members. We wanted to know why they were members, if they knew who their steward was, and what they wanted from their union. And for those who were not members, we wanted to know why and what we could do as a union to encourage them to join. Our folks were amazed that we wanted to talk to them. We listened to their needs and concerns, which is the single most important tool in our toolbox. And we shared our values and the value of belonging to a union. How we advocate for ourselves and our students, and how we are part of a much broader network. Though through these one-to-ones, we were able to keep the members we had, and we were able to sign up those who had not joined. And now, we are ready in Minnesota to take this model and expand it to the entire Minnesota labor movement as we prepare for the 2022 and 2024 elections. The Minnesota AFL-CIO, like our federal, state, and local federated bodies is the best vehicle to move political programs in our respective jurisdictions. But to win progress for all working people, we need the full support of the labor movement and the investment to strengthen our local labor body structures. Thank you.
Can you hear me? Let's move to politics and legislation and to hear from someone who has been the architect of members running for state, local, school board positions all throughout New Jersey. New Jersey State AFL-CIO President Charlie Wukanik, whose state Fed structure is now set to both help people, labor members, win seats and support the passage of local, state, and federal legislation. Charlie.
Oh, no.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Let me start by saying thank you, President Shuler. Congratulations to you and Secretary Treasurer Fred Bredman. God bless you. Let me also say thank you to President Weingarten, and thanks to you and President Saunders for your leadership and work in building the political program and strengthening our state and local central bodies. Over 25 years ago, we decided to be intentional about electing union members to public office because nobody represents working families better than union members themselves. We established an independent member-to-member labor candidate program. Today, union members represent New Jersey's working families in government from local school boards to the halls of Congress. Because our labor candidate program, union member candidates have sponsored nearly every piece of progressive labor legislation in our state. New Jersey was first in the nation to have project labor agreements, card check for the public sector, paid family leave, and earned sick leave. Thank you. Recently, the New Jersey legislature passed our seed to sale recreational cannabis law, which has the strongest labor and social justice provisions in the nation. A member of AFT Local 857 was recently elected to the mayor of Perth Amboy, alongside a member of AFSCME Local 2269, who was elected to that city council. One of their very first acts was to pass and sign into law a project labor agreement for the construction of a new $250 million high school, which is projected to create 2,000 jobs for the members of our local building trades council. In New Jersey, we're all about building and strengthening our central labor councils. All volunteer activities are coordinated through our 12 central labor councils. These include labor-to-labor walks, phone and text banks, organizing activities, and legislative initiatives. Our labor walks are now the place to be during the election season. We don't send members to the party headquarters anymore. Endorsed candidates come to our union halls. They come to see us, and they see the power of our diverse union members working together with the single goal of electing all endorsed candidates, and especially union member candidates. The key to our success is learning from our affiliates what the key issues are, and then educating, training, and communicating with rank and file members around those issues. Year after year, affiliated unions provide both the financial and volunteer resources needed to win. And in the past 25 years, we've notched nearly 1,200 victories. Now we have union members elected and serving in policy-making public offices all across the state and in Washington, D.C. Nothing happens in New Jersey without union members at the decision-making tables. That's the power of this program, and I want to thank the New Jersey AFL-CIO staff, our Central Labor Council presidents, all of our affiliates, President Shuler, and Secretary Fred Redmond for their continued support. God bless you. Thank you, Randy.
Thank you, Charlie. As President Shuler said before, elections have consequences, and you see the positive consequences because of what has happened in New Jersey. Thank you, Charlie. And, you know, I hear a lot of people say, oh, we can do it in a state like New Jersey, in a state like Minnesota, but what about the South? Well, you're going to hear from Vonda McDaniel next, president of the Central Labor Council of Nashville and Middle Tennessee, about the important role of Central Labor Councils in supporting both traditional and non-traditional organizing. Vonda.
Thank you so much, President Weingarten. Hello. I am honored to share that the great work that state federations and central labor councils are doing to build the labor movement. In every community in America today, there are workers who want to organize in their workplaces. And it is the solidarity of the whole labor movement in our communities, expressed by our state feds and central labor councils, that can make a difference against employer power and can point the way to a better path for everyone, for workers, for employers, and for our communities. In my community, Nashville, Tennessee, planted in the middle of a right-to-work state, our Central Labor Council has negotiated a community benefits agreement with the Nashville Soccer Club. It provides worker safety and workforce development rights to the workers at their stadium, as well as new jobs, affordable housing for our Nashville community. Our CLC, like so many others, has a strategy for building coalitions in our community that support worker organizing and approaches economic development that benefits the whole community. Our strategy depends on both the involvement of rank and file union members and community engagement that includes critical alliances with communities of faith. When we bring our voices together, we are so much stronger, and so many more things are possible. And it's the type of approach that has led to the AFL-CIO President's Initiative on Organizing, working hand in glove with Central Labor Councils in Chicago, Houston, and Seattle, to move broad-based organizing initiatives that are the model for what we hope to see all across the country. In Nashville and Seattle, local labor movements have used the political power of the labor movement to level the playing field for workers. As part of the Seattle's President Organizing Initiative, stadium workers have won union recognition. And we're all following the innovative digital hiring hall that the Seattle POI has started. There, the labor movement, partnering with community organizations, is connecting working people with opportunities for high-quality jobs. So I am pleased to be here today to highlight what state federations and central labor councils can do when we invest in them. supporting working people all across this country who are fighting to build and organize our glorious labor movement.
Thank you, Vonda, so much. And finally, our last speaker on stage will be Hani Khalil, who is the executive director of the Texas Gulf Coast Area Labor Federation. And Hani will highlight some of the critical work the labor movement has done in lifting up and rebuilding communities. Hani.
Good morning. So I don't think anyone would disagree that residents of the Texas Gulf Coast get hit with more than our fair share of disasters. Am I right? And when those disasters hit, union members are impacted like everybody else. And each time we rebuild with our community, because we are the community, but also to build labor's power through coalitions with community allies. It was 5 years ago this August that Hurricane Harvey hit and dumped 60 inches of rain over 5 days on Houston. It was one of the worst storms we'd had in a region that is constantly hit with hurricanes. And as the water receded, our labor federation got to work. We assembled muckout crews to help union members in the wider Houston community, giving priority to seniors whose homes were ravaged by the storm. And then when the rebuilding phase began, we pulled together the building trades and community partners to establish the Build Houston Better Coalition. And we won a community workforce agreement that included a $15 minimum wage and apprenticeship utilization requirements and OSHA training requirements and local hire and other labor standards for multifamily housing projects that were funded by federal relief dollars through the City of Houston's Housing Department. People said we wouldn't do it, but we did. And so this leveled the playing field for union contractors. It set the gold standard for responsible construction. It opened up new markets for our unions to grow. It's also been a precedent that we've capitalized on to win victories at the county level and in Houston's bid for the 2026 World Cup, and more. And it showed how a coalition of unions and community partners and elected officials can work together to lift up the community. And in the face of the pandemic, we built on that foundation. More than 60 unions and community allies came together to form the Keep Harris Housed Coalition. And together, we connected more than 7,000 working families with legal aid and rental assistance that they needed to stay in their homes. We set up vaccination hubs at union halls, inviting union members and their families and friends to help get the community vaccinated. Now, to be clear, we build these coalitions not because it's a nice thing to do, but because it's vital to our interests. It is core to our strategy. In a region with 5% union density, a state with 5% union density, we know we cannot do it alone. We need the community with us. And so we need to build long-term, durable, highly trusted, multiracial coalitions to be able to win at the ballot box and at City Hall. And our commitment to building that trust between labor and the community has led us to take bolder stands on issues of democracy and equity, important to both our members and the community, even though they may sometimes be controversial. For instance, we stood up for racial justice and policing reform after Houston native George Floyd was murdered. We stood up for voting rights when Republican legislators and Governor Abbott tried to suppress them. And we came out for gun safety reform after Uvalde. So doing this work with the community isn't easy. It's challenged us to have courageous conversations, to work through disagreements, to take risks. But it's work the labor movement must do if we intend to include and organize all workers. Let me say it again. It is work the labor movement must do if we intend to include and organize all workers. So these coalitions were built during times of adversity. So we know we can do hard things together. The power we're building with community allies has enabled us to transform moments of crisis into moments of opportunity. And together, we're in a stronger position now to win the change that working Texans want and deserve. Thank you very much.
So, as I thank Bernie and Charlie and Vonda and Hanny again, you see the work in these areas: member engagement, politics and legislation, organizing, community. And I want to not only thank the four of these incredible leaders, but I would like every state, area, and central labor council leader and staff in this great hall to stand right now and be recognized as I thank all of you for being, come on, stand up. As I thank all of you, I know there are some of you there, as I thank all of you for being that center of gravity, for being this infrastructure, for being the key to connect our movement to this moment. Thank you very, very much.